Solvite omnes. Today I'm going to be talking about Tullus Hostilius, the third king of Rome. After a second interregnum, the Senate ratified Tullus Hostilius as king. So again, and this is after the death of Numa Pompilius. He was the grandson of Hostus Hostilius, first to die in the Sabine conflict. So when the Sabines attacked Rome under their king Titus Tatius, Hostus Hostilius was the champion who fought against the Sabines, and he died in battle. Hostilius was a different man than Numa. His lust for action surpassed even Romulus. So Tullus Hostilius, this new king, the third king of Rome, felt the Romans had become weak under Numa because they spent all their time worshiping the gods and not enough time cultivating their martial arts. They did not spend enough time fighting and doing things that the Romans are supposed to do, going out and conquer and so forth. So he decided that they needed to start a war. And so it happened that there was reciprocal cattle raids happening between the Romans and the people and the Alban people, or the Albans. Both sides sent envoys to address the situations. The Romans made a demand for the restitution, and when the Albans' leader, Gaius Cluanius, refused, the Romans declared war. And then here we go. Here's a picture from the Areopagus, which was created by Augustus. It shows priests. And in early Roman history, the Romans used priests as envoys. Albans, Alba Longa. So who are the Albans? What's the city of Alba Longa? Just to remind ourselves from earlier in Roman history, the Albans were a strong people, also of Trojan stock. By the way, Romulus came from the city of Alba Longa. And then Alba Longa was established by Ascanius, the son of Aeneas, and he came from the city of Lavinium. And Lavinium was founded by Trojan Aeneas, the son of Venus. So Romulus and the Romans are all related to the city of Alba Longa. So this is almost like a civil war. All right. Now, once the war started, the Albans massed together a huge army and quickly besieged the city. They got there so quick the Romans weren't even prepared. The Albans started building a trench around the city. But while preparing their position, Cluanius died, the king of Alba Longa. And a spot where he died was called Cluanius's Trench, which supposedly you can still see today. After Cluanius's death, the Albans selected Metius Vifentius as their leader. Before the battle was to begin, Metius requested a meeting with Tullus. Metius pointed out a war between the Albans and the Romans would weaken both states and allow the Etruscans to easily conquer both of them. Remember, the Etruscans were a powerful people who lived north of the river Tiber. Metius proposed that this war be settled by a fight between champions. And so whoever champions won, then that group would be the winner without everyone fighting, and their state would become superior to the other state. So the other state who lost would become a vassal state and would have to do whatever the winning group requested. And it so happened that each side had a set of champion triplets. So there just happened to be in both armies one set of triplets. So there was two sets of triplets for fighting. The Horatii for the Romans and the Curiatii for the Albans. So Horatii on the Roman side, Curiatii on the Alban side. The triplets began to fight. So what happened is the army separated out, made a big open space for the two sides to fight. Everyone could watch, and the Horatii came out from the Roman army, the Curiatii from the Alban army, and then at an agreed point in time, they fought. The three Curiatii were all quickly wounded by the three Horatii. It's looking good. But then two of the Horatii fell and were killed in battle. The last of the Horatii, unwounded, decided to run. So there was three Albans on the one Roman. As the three Curiatii chased the last remaining of the Horatii, they began to separate due to the differing degree of their wounds. So one was not wounded too much, one was wounded pretty bad, and then one was really wounded. And they all did not stay together, but stretched out in a line. Then the last of the Harati stopped and was able to kill the closest of the Kirati. So quickly he turned and killed the one who was least wounded. Then he was able to kill the next one of the Kirati. And before you know it, it is all over. When the last of the Kirati came to the Roman, he was exhausted by running and lost the blood. The last of the Harati said, "I've killed two already to avenge my brother's ghosts. I offer the last to settle our quarrel, that Rome may be mistress of Alba." With these last words, he plunged the sword into the throat of the enemy, who was now too weak to hold up his shield. And he won. Here's a picture from the 17th century showing the last of the Harati slaying the last of the Kirati. And then he proceeded to strip the enemy of their weapons and to take them as spoils. And with this, the Romans won, and the people of Alba Longa lost, and the city of Alba Longa became a vassal state to the Romans. But the story does not end there. After the last of Harati had won and gotten triple spoils, he marched home. At the gates of the city, he came across his sister who was betrothed to one of the Kirati. She recognized her brother wearing a cloak that she had made with her own hands for her fiancé. So she recognized that her brother had killed her fiancé. She started to cry and weep. And an uncontrollable rage filled Horatius, and he said, "Take your girl's love and give it to your lover in the underworld. What is Rome to such as you or your brothers, living or dead? So perish all women who mourn the enemy." And then he stabbed her in the heart. Tullus Hostilius, the king, had a problem. Horatius, who was a hero of the state, had just committed cold-blooded murder. Tullus called together special officers, and he passed the buck. And these special officers were called the Duumvirs. There was two of them. And they were selected to pass judgment on Horatius to have a trial. Horatius was convicted and sentenced to death. But because of the pleading of his father, Horatius was spared, and his father had to perform certain ceremonies at public cost to absolve his son of his crime. To Livy's day, the Horatian family still performed these ceremonies. After the battle, the city of Alba Longa became a vassal state of Rome. Later, the Etruscan towns of Fidenae and Veii decided to attack Rome. The Alans promised to help, but when the battle was about to begin, Metius Vifentius had the Albans retreat. Tullus, in order not to have his men disheartened, told them that he had ordered the Albans to retreat to outflank the Etruscans. The Romans won the battle without the help of the people of Alba Longa. But Tullus then seized Metius and said to him, "Metius Vifentius, were you capable of learning to abide by your word, I should let you live. I should have taught you myself, but you are not capable. No medicine can cure your mind's disease." Two chariots were then brought up, each drawn by four horses. Metius was tied spread eagle to both of them. At the touch of the whip, two teams sprang forward in opposite directions, carrying with them the fragments of the mangled body still held by the ropes. All the eyes are averted from the disgusting spectacle, never in all our history to be repeated. After the death of Vifentius, the Romans destroyed the city of Alba Longa, except the temples. They did not destroy the temples, and then expand their population by taking in the Albans. So the people of Alba Longa became part of Rome. And this is another idea that the Romans talk about a lot in their history, of taking people in and making them Roman. Tullus expanded the ranks of the Senate to the Tullii, the Servilii, the Quintii, the Genani, the Curiatii, and the Coelii. So these families who came from the city of Alba Longa became part of the Senate. He built a new Senate house called the Curia Hostilia. And then he fought a war and defeated the Sabines. So he kept on fighting. Soon, and this is many, you know, this went on for a while, there was a huge outbreak of plague that went through Rome. People were concerned that it was because they had forgotten their religious ways. Since they spent so much time fighting now, they had not spent enough time worshiping the gods. Soon even Tullus became sick. He happened to find the commentary's Numa in the palace, and he performed rites unknown to anyone. However, his procedure was incorrect. Jupiter was angry, and the palace was struck by lightning, and he perished in flames. Tullus won great glory as a soldier and reigned for 32 years. And there we go. That is Tullus Hostilius, the third king of Rome. Volete omnes lingua Latina est vita.